In this video, we are going to talk about the Procter & Gamble stock. So before starting this video, please like this video and subscribe to this channel for our future updates. It's reasonable to assume that Procter & Gamble, NYSE, PG, stock is a secure, set it and forget it, investment as long as the American public buys household and personal items. It isn't known for being a high flyer. However, if you look at a multi-year chart, you'll be amazed to discover how high the PG stock price is. With PG stock, you can time your entry. When you genuinely appreciate a firm but have missed out on significant gains, it's always a challenge. As a result, investors are conflicted, frightened of missing out on further gains. However, for value investors like me, it's difficult to justify purchasing stock. This is especially true now that the price of PG stock has risen steadily from roughly $72 in April 2018 to around $124 this month. That's an incredible run for a stock with a low beta, but it is what it is. We must operate with the price on the chart, not with what we believe the price should be. The fact that Procter & Gamble stock now has a trailing 12-month price-to-earnings ratio of 78.4 is incredible. This isn't your father's or grandfather's market, though. Consecutive earnings beats have likely aided the current PG stock price, with the most recent earnings reports delighting both analysts and shareholders. PG's earnings per share for the third quarter of 2019 came in at $1.37, exceeding the analyst average forecast of $1.24. Meanwhile, quarterly revenues of $17.80 billion surpassed the analyst consensus of $17.42 billion. The report exceeds even our heightened expectations, according to RBC analysts. A company that is still number one. To be honest, I don't blame the experts for having higher expectations for what could be the best consumer products firm. Whether it's Gillette razors, Crest toothpaste, Dawn dish soap, Pampers diapers, or Vicks cough drops, your family is likely to utilize at least one Procter & Gamble product. One of the reasons we've continually suggested PG stock is the company's mastery of promotion and branding. In a study on supermarket promos, NYU's Maxime C. Cohen and MIT's Jeremy J. Callis and Georgia Parakis write, retail promotions have a considerable impact on boosting sales and influencing customers. Promotions affect 90% of adult consumers in terms of the amount they spend and the things they buy. The fact that Procter & Gamble's products are in so many homes right now is proof positive that the company can still get into your thoughts and your wallet. Procter & Gamble is making strides in e-commerce. P&G's place in the online world may be questioned by those who follow the corporation closely. Its plans to buy Billy, an online distributor of women's shaving equipment, were shelved earlier this month when the Federal Trade Commission filed an official complaint against the deal in December. While it isn't a death blow for the corporation, it is a significant setback for a company with deep roots in the physical world. Pampers diapers, Tide detergent, and Bounty paper towels are just a handful of P&G's product categories. It's not easy to shift any of Procter & Gamble's $70 billion in yearly revenue from offline to online. Outside of purchases that the FTC appears to be ready to prevent, some may believe it is impossible. Think again if you think Procter & Gamble isn't ready for the next era of consumerism. E-commerce sales accounted for 11% to 12% of the company's revenue in the quarter ended in October. This has increased from about 6% of P&G's top line just a few years ago. It's still not enough to label Procter & Gamble an e-commerce behemoth, but it's a step in the right direction. It's all part of the digital strategy. And there's a reason Procter & Gamble has been able to maintain a low-key digital presence. New CEO David Taylor led the company in this way. Taylor shifted his attention online in 2017 after completing the streamlining, via divestment, initiated by his predecessor Alan Laffey. That was the source of P&G's most threatening competition. Yes, upstart brands like Dollar Shave Club and Harry's are included. According to Euromonitor, they were a main reason for P&G's Gillette brand of razors losing market share from 70% to less than 50% in the United States by 2017. Procter & Gamble has lost more than just market share. Consumers who had previously confined their searches to what they found on the shelves of their local stores were introduced to niche brands of detergent, skincare products, and more as a result of the rise of direct-to-consumer purchasing. P&G Ventures developed skincare brand Meliderm and bug spray Zevo, and purchased Natural Deodorant Company Native in 2017, which started as an online-only product, because of this market shift. Taylor and colleagues, on the other hand, aren't just purchasing and bullying their way into the e-commerce world. The company's cautious approach has proved surprisingly sophisticated. Taylor used the term smart audiences in 2019 to describe the company's use of digital consumer data to fine-tune its marketing message. There are 350 separate data-defined segmentations of more than 1 billion users in the company's database. That's a lot of different ways to personalize marketing messages, and P&G uses artificial intelligence capabilities from Alphabet's Google Cloud to analyze the data. Granted, there are macroeconomic reasons beyond Procter & Gamble's control. You knew I'd bring up the trade war sooner or later, didn't you? PG stock investors, on the other hand, don't have to, or shouldn't try to, predict future economic developments. Procter & Gamble's chief financial officer, John Moeller, has a comment on this topic that I particularly like. We aren't in the business of projecting consumer acceleration or slowing. So, in terms of market growth in the future, your prediction is as good as ours. I admire the tone of humility, are you listening, Elon? And I am confident that PG stock will eventually weather any macroeconomic storm. Still, with the current price and P/E ratio, I can't bring myself to recommend a long position until the valuation falls or at the very least, rests, i.e., goes sideways, for a bit. In conclusion, even Procter & Gamble's most ardent supporters would struggle to name concrete adjustments the business has made in its quest to modernize. Similarly, investors may find it difficult to pinpoint precise strategy features that will help P&G prepare for a digitally driven future. The Procter & Gamble we know and love now resembles the Procter & Gamble we knew and loved 20 years ago, raising questions about its continued relevance. As a result, it's natural to conclude that the massive and venerable business is still on the defensive, which stymies the bullish case. Take a close look behind the hood, though, and you'll see that this isn't your grandfather's P&G. Even if it isn't acknowledged, it has progressed. For the foreseeable future, Procter & Gamble, PG, will be able to maintain gradual and steady revenue and earnings growth. That isn't to say that investors should anticipate double-digit revenue and earnings growth in the future. However, it does lay the ground for possible revenue and earnings shocks in the near future. It also elevates Procter & Gamble to the level of a must-have brand that dependable investors saw in the business a few decades ago. What do you think about our video? What do you think about the stats? Let us know in the comments below. If you enjoy this video and want to hear from me again, be sure to hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications before you go. Thanks for watching.